Wave Sound Audiobooks presents an unabridged recording of Dark Arena by Jack Beaumont, narrated by Julian Pulvermacher. To my wife and children, and to my brothers in arms, patriam servando victoriam tulit. Paul. Prague in early February wasn't all that bad, thought Paul de Garde, even for a southern Frenchman accustomed to the Mediterranean warmth. There was no snow on the ground in the Czech capital, but de Garde waited in the Jungmann Square Starbucks where his toes wouldn't freeze. He'd been in his holding zone for 40 minutes. He walked his safety route before arriving at the coffee shop. However, last night's insomnia and the 7 coffees he'd drunk were not calming. For now, he focused on not fidgeting or looking impatient, both tells that watchers would look for. At 44 minutes, de Garde wrapped a plain scarf around his neck, covertly dismantled his phone, and poured the pieces into his jacket pocket. Standing, he picked up a tourist camera from the table in front of him, dropped it in his other pocket, and emerged into the afternoon. The cold air tightened his jaw as he moved through Jungmann Square, his gait relaxed, but his mind a laundry list of actions and contingencies. Paul de Garde may have been a fully commissioned case officer, an officier traitant, or OT, of the DGSE, France's Foreign Secret Service, but he was not from operations. His academic background in Russian foreign policy and his fluency in the Russian language had seen him recruited as an analyst by the company 20 years earlier. For analysts who worked with the DR, the Direction du Renseignement, the intelligence division of the company, some basic training in clandestine liaison was required, which he'd used at his 2 embassy external posts in Greece and Turkey. There were rules for how he conducted himself in the field, even if his job was the relatively low-risk processing of human sources. He had 6 minutes between Starbucks and his contact point. He had to be nonchalant while detecting and memorizing everything on the route. He knew from his fieldwork that once he was back in Paris, someone from the DO, Direction des Opérations, could gatecrash a debrief and start asking detailed questions about who and what was around him during a meeting or a route. He walked across Franciskanska Zarada Park, through the Svetozor Passage with the tourist crowds, and came out in Voditskova Street, where he turned right to create a visual loss for potential followers. He walked 50 meters up the street before crossing it, giving him an excuse to look for traffic and determine followers. He moved into a medieval walkway, passed a line of 8 advertising panels, and walked at a slight angle to them so as to remove a convenient line of sight for any followers. He advanced to a set of steps at the end of the lane, where a luminous sign indicated Kino Lucerna. Inside the building's gallery, a horse was suspended upside down from the vaulted ceiling. He took a few photos, playing out his tourist legend and allowing a final check for followers. By the time he lowered his camera, he knew he was clean. If things went wrong, the camera shots would let the company know his location before he disappeared. He pushed the thought of capture from his head. Unlike the DO operatives, he had his secret weapon right against his heart in his jacket pocket, his diplomatic passport. He climbed the stairs to the cafe, choosing a table located slightly back from the bay windows with a view of the gallery and the stairs. Lotus was due to arrive at 3 p.m., which left de Garde 15 minutes to sit and watch. He ordered a coffee and prepared for the wolf to show the tip of his nose. The main operational security method he had to adhere to when managing clandestine drops was the itinéraire de sécurité, IS, which involved walking routes, finding angles, checking in reflections, and creating points de passage obligé, zones that a follower had to commit to in order to maintain their tail, and which made it obvious they were following. Besides the IS, there was also a hygiene protocol called the tourniquet, which involved a team of at least 2 OTs who would overwatch a security route and clear an operative out of their mission zone, ensuring no followers. He didn't have a team overwatching this operation. so he focused on his tradecraft and waited, controlling his breathing and refraining from fidgeting. If Lotus was a no-show after 25 minutes, he'd play it by the book. There was never a compelling need to wait more than 10 minutes past the agreed meet time. He'd arrived from Paris the previous morning, and at his hotel, the old Royal Post, he'd asked to be moved to another room immediately after check-in. Then he'd walked to the French embassy, located west of the Vltava River. Degard considered the Vltava to be the natural demarcation between his life and mission zones. In his mission zone, he was a spy whose every movement and interaction was controlled by the company. In his life zone, he was a mid-level diplomat with declared duties, none of them controversial. At the Baroque palace that housed the French embassy, Degard had met the chief of station, who worked under the cover of cultural attaché of the embassy. He briefed the local DGSE man on the real purpose of his visit, and the backup he would need if the contact with his source did not go as planned. Contact with an already recruited source did not usually necessitate a DO protection scheme, so Degard was responsible for his own safety. Now, as he sipped his coffee in the Café Luciana, his Paris apartment in the 13th arrondissement, where his wife Katie and daughter Louise were waiting for him, seemed very far away. He tried not to think about Paris. Some operatives in the company could spend weeks in the field under these conditions, somehow remaining calm and focused, and keeping their families in a separate mental compartment. He didn't know how they did it. Instead, he turned his mind to the meeting with Lotus, the codename for Lado Devashvili, a former member of the Georgian government who'd branched into the business world in the early 1990s when the Soviet bloc fell. Devashvili spent very little time in Tbilisi with his family, given his job kept him so busy meeting prostitutes at luxury hotels. Lotus provided everything that might be required by a foreign government or its contractors: drugs, escorts, boats, planes, IDs, and weapons. What the DGSE required was hard to come by intelligence. There was no collusion between the company and Lotus. Only an exchange of documents for cash. Degard had spoken to him once, through the operational agent of the DO who had recruited Lotus, and transitioned Degard to become the handler. That three-way meeting in Vienna had been a memorable one for Degard, not just because he'd met Lotus for the first time, but because he'd met the well-known Aguilar from the DGSE's Y Division, the section responsible for clandestine operations. Lotus's face resembled a metal plate chiseled for many years by expensive vodka bottles, in the center of which sat two small sunken eyes. Even Lotus had been wary around Aguilar, Degard noted. After the meeting, Aguilar had warned Degard to be particularly cautious around Lotus. Avoid talking to him, and always be very careful to carry out your personal security measures. Imagine you're dealing with a cobra in a round room. Since that initial encounter, Degard had met Lotus clandestinely in the major cities of various European countries, always under the guise of business trips. Degard contacted Lotus via the standard liaison plan, making an appointment and stating his needs, and the Georgian appeared miraculously to pass on information that was generally considered high quality. While impressed by the level of information, Degard would have preferred not to come within 500 kilometers of the man. At 3:01 p.m., a tall, fat man wearing a long coat entered the Lucerna's gallery. Lotus was well within the company's accepted 1 or 2 minutes window for a contact. His tweed trilby hat was in his hand rather than on his head, indicating that he didn't think he'd been followed. However, Degard's position gave him a view of everyone who came into the building behind the Georgian. Degard took the green Geo magazine from his bag and put it on the table in front of him, indicating to Lotus that he'd detected no followers and the exchange could proceed. Lotus crushed his cigarette beneath his heel and climbed the marble stairs to the cafe, where he sat at a free table between Degard and the exit. He put his hat on the table, took a packet of cigarettes from his pocket, and put it next to the hat. then signaled to a waitress and ordered a whiskey. Degarde paid his bill, keeping the receipt so he could charge his coffee to his mission expenses, and stood up. Tucking his magazine under his arm, he walked to the exit. As he passed Lotus's table, he let his hand drag and retrieved the packet of cigarettes. Lotus did not react. Everything happened so naturally that only a trained observer would have seen the drop. Degarde walked down the marble stairs to the foyer and left through an exit that neither man had used when they arrived. He turned right and headed towards the National Museum, pausing along the way to take tourist snaps. At the statue of St. Wenceslas, he entered the adjacent metro station, turned left at the bottom of the stairs, and walked with the crowd towards the disabled toilet. After locking himself in, Degarde pulled the packet of cigarettes from his pocket and opened it to reveal four tightly folded A4 sheets. Three of them were printouts of emails containing the names and addresses of the senders. Degarde skimmed them. In Russian, the writers of the emails asked Lotus to set up various services for their benefit in the Cypriot city of Larnaca, and also on the Lebanese and Syrian coasts in the Mediterranean. Degarde felt his blood run cold as he unfolded the fourth sheet and saw the letterhead. It was a classified document from the Russian Defense Ministry indicating the appointment of specialist agents from the SVR, the Civil Foreign Intelligence Agency, at the Russian military base at Tartus in Syria, and the deployment of intelligence drones at the Khmeimim Air Base, another Russian facility in Syria. He wondered how such a significant document had fallen into Lotus's hands, and decided it warranted staying an extra night in Prague to play out his tourist legend. His training emphasized that if an OT had any doubts while in the field, or had a sense of heightened risk, they should put any followers to sleep by spending hours wandering a city in tourist mode with no hint of training. He took his small camera out of his pocket and, after setting the sheets flat on the floor, photographed them twice each, making sure to erase each photo as soon as it was taken. His glasses slipped over his nose and his hand was shaking. The company's technical division would retrieve data from the camera's memory card upon its return, and the numbers of the remaining photos would follow each other in the event of an inspection. Having roughly verified the content of the drop, it was time to move to the second phase of his contact: remuneration. Degarde tore the sheets into tiny pieces and let them fall into the toilet. He would have liked to proudly exhibit the Russian classified document to colleagues at his intelligence desk, or BER. It was quite a coup. But he wasn't going to travel across Europe with such a dangerous prize in his possession. He flushed the toilet several times, removed an envelope from his bag, which he placed in his jacket pocket. Then he left the bathroom and took the westbound metro line. No longer carrying compromising material, he began to feel calmer as the train picked up speed. But he would only breathe easily on the plane back to Paris, he knew, when this was all over. He emerged from Mustek station and walked through the pretty streets of Old Prague until he arrived at Svatého Jiljí Church, entering the building through the side door on Zvata Street. Lotus sat alone in the first row of the left aisle, seemingly deep in prayer. Degarde wondered which saint would listen to him. Apart from a few tourists and a priest checking his candles, the church was otherwise empty. Degarde sat at the other end of Lotus's pew, and without turning his head from the transept, took the envelope from his pocket and placed it gently between them. Inside was 10,000 euros, which Lotus would probably spend on vodka and a girl. With this Christian thought, Degarde stood and crossed himself, as Lotus put his hat on the envelope. Degarde walked down the central aisle and stepped out onto Husova Street. He plunged into the small passage in front of the church, to the left of the beer museum, and set about exiting his mission zone. He walked past the medieval torture museum and over the 700-year-old Charles Bridge, which was the point de passage obligé leading to his life zone. For followers to stay on his heels, they would have to reveal themselves on the bridge. He breathed out slowly when he reached the far bank and took some tourist snaps, turning to face the way he'd come. He was on the alert for someone he might have noticed earlier in the day, without announcing that he was looking. But he saw no faces he'd seen before, and no parasite gestures that were supposed to look natural but were forced. He took another photo, committing to the role of tourist now. He would spend the next 24 hours meandering the streets and visiting museums, taking 100 shots of Prague. He wished he could show his wife and daughter this city, so beautiful under the late winter sun, and so relaxing when you didn't have to retrieve secret documents from one of the company's most dangerous sources. Considering himself clean, he hurried up the stairs into the lobby of the old Royal Post and asked to extend his stay for an extra night. There was just so much to see in this beautiful city, he told the woman on reception. Then he went up to his room and changed his flight. After buying souvenirs in the airport's departures concourse, Degarde sat at the bar and ordered a whiskey. He was exhausted. The extra day in Prague had been spent walking in his office shoes, and his feet ached. Easing back in his seat, he rummaged in his jacket pocket, took out the various pieces of his phone, put it together, and turned it on. He was pleased to see that there was no missed call from Katie. Even though he'd been away a night longer than planned, she would have understood that he couldn't break from his legend to call her. He sent a text to the embassy's cultural attaché, thanking him for his time and his welcome, then pulled the battery from the phone again. The chief of station would understand that Degarde was at the airport, and all was well. Degarde took a sip of his drink, thinking of those documents he had briefly seen in the bathroom. Tartus and Kamim. Why would Moscow send more SVR men there? What were the Russians preparing in the Mediterranean? The flight to Paris was announced. Degarde drained his whiskey and joined the queue to board, thinking that James Bond could not have done better. Paris. It was 9:32 p.m. when Paul disembarked at Charles de Gaulle and headed for the RER to get lost in the crowds and complete his last safety route alone before returning home. At the boarding area for the Paris-bound RER, the information panel indicated that the next train had been delayed by 45 minutes due to a signal failure. Degarde was tired and wanted to go home. Though he knew he should follow procedures, he considered that no opposing service was following him, so he returned to the terminal and went to the taxi stand. Putting a slight feeling of professional guilt to the back of his mind, he got into his assigned taxi and gave the driver his address. Then he turned on his phone and texted his wife. Just leaving the airport. I'll be home in 35 minutes. The following morning, Degarde ate breakfast with Katie and Louise, and then took the metro to Porte de Lille, emerging into the 20th arrondissement just before 9 a.m. It was still cold enough to warrant gloves and his black woolen beanie as he walked towards the company's headquarters. He wasn't too concerned with his hygiene. He'd walked his security routes the previous day in Prague before going to the airport, and he didn't feel the need to do another before entering the Centre Administratif des Tourelles, known colloquially as the CAT, even though he knew many OTs did. Instead, he was anticipating his debriefing with sector manager Marie Lafont at 3 p.m. He'd have time to drop the camera's SD card with the technical division, the DT, before writing his report. He was eager to get the photos of the documents before lunch, so he could analyze them before the debriefing. Lafont could be forensic about source materials. He entered the DGSE building on Boulevard Mortier, known as La Piscine by many employees because it was beside an indoor swimming pool where so many of them exercised. He passed through the many security points. A hodgepodge of Napoleonic and late 1960s architecture with a modern American overlay, the headquarters of France's Foreign Intelligence Service looked like it had been constructed to completely confuse an outsider. He walked downstairs to the DT's basement level, which was vast, and ran under Boulevard Mortier into the building over the road. In the administrative area, he dropped the SD card with a techie, who sported a flock of seagull's haircut and a T-shirt with a picture of an audio cassette, and asked for the prod to be sent to his office. The guard went back upstairs to the cafeteria to grab a coffee and pain au chocolat, and seeing four of his colleagues on the velvet benches at one of the round tables, he wandered over to join them. "Haven't seen you for a couple of days, Paul," said Stefan, a DR analyst on Degard's floor, who worked at the Africa section. "You been on a trip?" "Yes," said Degard, unable to repress a proud smile. "But I can't tell you more than that. You don't have the need to know." His colleagues laughed. "James Bond for a day," said Roman Precheur, the counter-proliferation analyst. "Well, he'd better learn to drink a martini," said Stefan. "Last time I saw Paul drinking gin, he threw up on himself." "Bond drinks vodka martinis," said Romain. "Even worse," said Stefan. "Paul passes out with vodka." "Okay, okay," said Degard, smiling as he stirred sugar into his coffee. "The only thing I can tell you is that the quality of the prod is as good as the girls in the country I visited." "Let's hope you weren't in Pakistan then, mon pote," said Stefan, which triggered more laughter. He walked the stairs up into the main building and entered his office by inputting the week's digital code. In front of him were various files containing information grabbed by sources over the previous months. He was expected to take in strands of information and synthesize pieces of a puzzle. He had barely closed the door behind him when there was a knock. He opened it to find an internal courier, who handed him a sealed envelope containing the printed documents retrieved from his SD card. Closing the door again, he perused the contents closely. One of the documents Lotus had supplied was an email in Russian about an event scheduled for 2 weeks' time in Monaco, aboard a yacht called Azam. Degard couldn't remember this email from his quick verification in Prague. The Russian term for making a deal was used in the email, and the language suggested a very high level of discussion. There was also a phone number listed for an unidentified person who seemed to be a person of interest, a POI for the Russians. Degard knew immediately that Lafont would want more detail, so he left his office and walked down to the department that generated intelligence from open sources. He asked them to research Azam and have the information for him by 2 p.m. Back in his office, he called the DT, thanked them for the SD images, and asked for a phone environment on the phone number in the email. If they succeeded, it would tell him where the phone was being used. Then he opened the report section of the DGSE computer system and wrote two reports. One was for the analysts, an O report written objectively that did not allow the reader to see the identity of the writer or the sources of the intelligence. And the other one was called R and explained how the contact with Lotus was done and the security measures he took around it. As Degard filed the reports, the internal courier knocked at his door and dropped off a file that contained pictures, specifications, and ownership details of Azam. It was an 82-meter, 10-stateroom motor yacht, Degard learned, built in the Netherlands in 2017 at a cost of 78 million euros. It was owned by a UAE shell company, and its home port was Port Vell, Barcelona. It didn't feature in any social pages, and it didn't appear to be owned by a movie star or a Silicon Valley billionaire. There wasn't much on Azam, but that wouldn't stop Lafont asking for more. At 2:58 p.m., Degard dropped his iPhone in the box outside the E-Sector briefing room on the third floor and took a seat at the large oval meeting table across from the current head of BER Europe, Lars Magnus. Magnus was tall and youngish and seemed a little spooked by the presence of his immediate predecessor in the role, Marie Lafont, who sat beside him. Marie Lafont was a well-dressed brunette in her early 40s. She was smart and driven, and had field experience, which set her apart from many of the careerists at the company. Now a sector manager, she was running this operation. She didn't acknowledge Degard's arrival. She was on the phone, asking someone to join them. After a quick conversation, she hung up and turned to Degard. "Based on the prod I received this morning, I asked Briffaut to sit in. He should be here soon." Degard nodded and smiled, but his stomach clenched. Dominique Briffaut was the head of Y Division, he didn't often leave the bunker, as the headquarters of clandestine operations was known, to come for idle chats at the cat. "We need to know what they're planning on that boat," said Lafon, "and we need a phone environment to locate this number in the email." "It's done, boss," Degarde said, relieved he'd taken the initiative. The bearish form of Dominique Brifort entered the room, mug of coffee in his hand. He threw his coat on one of the spare chairs before taking a seat. "I have 20 minutes," he said. "Tell me what you've got." Lafont took Brifort through the document drop in Prague and the information gained from it, including the intelligence drones being staged in Khmeimim Air Base, the new SVR intelligence postings at Tartus, and the meeting in Monaco aboard Azam. So far, there was nothing to connect the phone number of the POI to the meeting on the yacht, she added. Brifort nodded through the briefing, asking only a few clarifying questions. The two senior people were economical with their words, Degarde noticed, and Magnus, despite being the head of BERE, stayed out of it. When Lafont had finished, Brifort turned to Degarde, focusing on him. "You've dealt with Lotus more than anyone. Was anything different about our Georgian friend in Prague?"
"I don't think so," said Degarde. "I never talk to him. I collect the prod and I give him the money."
"Sometimes a man doesn't speak with words," said Lafont with a very faint smile.
"Was there more eye contact than you're used to?" Brifort pushed. "Did he try to start a conversation?"
Degarde shook his head.
"It was business as usual."
The Y Division chief stared at Degarde in silence for a few seconds. Then he stood, grabbed his coat, and, talking to Lafont, said,
"I'll leave you to find out more about that phone number, and I'll investigate a way onto the boat. Let's talk tomorrow."
And then he was gone. Back in his office, Degarde found a message from the DT. The phone number on the Lotus prod had been used in Genoa several times in the past 24 hours. He sent an internal email to Lafont to let her know, then put all the material he'd amassed in his office safe, shut down his computer, and headed to the metro. He mulled over the debriefing as he traveled home. It had not gone terribly. After all, he'd retrieved the documents without screwing up the mission. But the prod had delivered more questions than answers. The Russians were increasing their presence on the Syrian coast, and the Palais d'Elysée would expect the French security services to tell them why. And it was important that the company get the information to the president before the Americans or the British could do it. It was a little before 7 p.m. when he turned the key in the door to the mid-19th century apartment in the 13th. The rent was subsidized, thanks to Katie's connections, and let himself in. No murmur of a TV or squawk from an Xbox. That meant Louise might be reading, which made Degarde happy. He was tired of nagging her about screen time. He hung up his coat, walked past the kitchen, and froze at the tableau before him. Three men in black balaclavas. His child on the sofa, crying. His wife on her knees, hands tied behind her back, a hand holding her blonde hair in a gloved fist.
"Who are you?"
Degarde demanded. But instead of answering, the man closest to him took one step towards him and swung a black handgun that caught Degarde in front of the right ear. Degarde staggered sideways into the sideboard, and a vase toppled from it and smashed on the floor.
"Dad!"
screamed Louise, and the third masked man slapped the child hard with the back of his hand. Her mother screamed before a big hand was clamped over her mouth. As Degarde pushed himself off the sideboard, he could see his wife's blue panties on the Persian rug beside the television screen, ripped at the sides. As he tried to stand, his vision swimming, his assailant kicked him in the balls. Degarde sagged to his knees, retching from the pain.
"So," said the man holding his struggling wife, "our friend lives like a king in beautiful Paris, eh, boys?"
His French was good, but heavily accented. Russian.
"What do you want?"
gasped Degarde, switching to Russian.
"My family have no part in this."
So I bring them into it? Asked the Russian, his grip on Katie's face tightening. You make another country your business and then claim you are immune? The French have such a sense of humor.
Louise stirred on the floor. Desgardes could see she was crying, tears running down her bruised face onto her Paris Saint-Germain shirt. She didn't have Katie's blonde hair, but the dark curls of Desgardes' mother. They framed a face full of fear and despair, and this hurt Desgardes more than his aching testicles.
Let them go, he said. I'll tell you what you want to know.
The lead man chuckled.
You hear that, boys? He's offering to talk.
The man who'd assaulted Desgardes also laughed. He grabbed the collar of Desgardes' woolen jumper and leaned in.
You'll talk, all right, comrade. You'll beg to do it.
Desgardes tried to reply, but the handgun slammed into his face again, and the scene before him went black. Chapter 1. Alec de Payns walked in the morning sunlight across the Pont des Bergs, spanning the Rhone, aiming for Geneva's Rive Droite. He'd been walking for 16 minutes, which had given him time to relax into his legend of a design student named Guillaume Roger, while also checking for followers. Geneva gave the surface impression of a wealthy, civilized city. However, it was also a historic crossroads of national interest and money, and De Payns was always careful in this city of spies. He stepped onto the Quai des Bergs, turned right, and walked along the river to where it opened into Lac de Genève, a haven for cruise boats and waterside bars and restaurants. He crossed onto the Quai du Mont Blanc, where the buildings became grand. One of them was the Ritz-Carlton Hotel, where he was due to meet his new friend Nikolai, a fellow student at the HEAD Design Academy, and his father. De Payns walked past two black Mercedes-Benz SUVs parked on the Ritz-Carlton apron, and entered the impressive white marble foyer with its black and white marble-tiled floor. There were two military-looking men in the lobby, dressed in black suits and tactical boots. De Payns had been expecting to see them, just as he was expecting to see the tall blonde student standing by the marble staircase, his red woolen scarf a raffish contrast to his expensive sand-colored suit. Guillaume, Nikolai waved flamboyantly, his Russian accent echoing around the room. Over here! Nikolai moved in for a hug, and De Payns could sense the security people watching them.
I hope you're not freaked out by these apes, said Nikolai, cocky and rude and eminently likable. My father only visits once a year, and he travels with this zoo. Is it okay?
I hardly noticed, said De Payns with a smile. Thought maybe Putin was in town. Nikolai laughed, then suddenly serious, said,
Dad has to have these people around him when he travels because of his work. Please don't be scared.
Thanks for the warning. I'll try to look brave, said De Payns. He started to walk away, but Nikolai grasped his bicep to stop him.
Dad and I love each other, he explained earnestly. But he thinks that the Russian climate is not good for me right now.
Nikolai bit his lip and looked away.
It just doesn't agree with me.
De Payns felt for him. Their friendship hadn't touched on the subject of Nikolai's sexuality. Now Nikolai was trying to find a way to warn his French friend that the Russian military and intelligence worlds did not accept gays. Even the sons and daughters of senior officers could find themselves sent to rehabilitation camps to be physically and psychologically broken down and turned into real Russians.
I understand, my friend, said De Payns.
I guess you are much better off in Geneva, especially for the arts. They moved into Fred by Fisker Bar, a pricey bar favored by Nikolai. De Payns usually avoided drinking there. Geneva had much better taverns. But his social manipulation had succeeded, and Nikolai now wanted his father to meet his new friend. Nikolai was not aware that also dotted around the hotel was De Payns' mission team, consisting of Templar, positioned in the hotel for threats, and Danny, who who was in the van controlling the comms. They'd both covered De Payne when he left the hotel, doing countertailing, and if necessary, they'd run a tourniquet. Aline, a petite blonde who worked for the company, was sitting alone in the Fiske bar drinking a Coke. She'd been recording audio and HD video of the bar with a hidden device for 10 minutes before De Payne arrived, and she'd clandestinely record the meeting from her table. Nikolai's father was already seated at his table when the two students arrived. De Payne flashed his big smile, in keeping with the youthful student persona he'd cultivated. "So pleased to meet you, Mr. Bashevsky," he said, using the surname assumed by Nikolai. "Welcome to Geneva." As they made small talk, De Payne assessed the man in front of him. He was around 50, with pale, cold eyes, a full head of salt and pepper hair, and a strong body. De Payne could feel the other man's eyes scrutinizing him in return, the father trying to work out if Nikolai and De Payne were lovers. After all, that was why Nikolai had been exiled to Geneva under a false name. When Nikolai rose to go to the bathroom, De Payne was left alone with his new acquaintance, whose real name was Lazar Subarov, a full colonel in the Russian FSB, the country's federal security service. Subarov was the number 2 ranking officer in the intelligence directorate for Chechnya. The company had codenamed him Keratin, and he was of value to France, which was why De Payne was going to try to turn a senior FSB officer while armed Russian henchmen stood guard outside.
"So," said Keratin, "Nikolai tells me you share a passion for art and for partying. I'm glad to hear he has found a like-minded friend, given he doesn't see his family much anymore."
"Well, actually," said De Payne, letting his expression harden, "I'm not your son's friend. I work for the French services. And from now on, you'll work for us, too." The blood drained from Keratin's face. De Payne recognized real fear in his eyes. "You could refuse," continued De Payne, "but I guess you know what happens if your colleagues discover that your son is not dead, like you told them, but hiding out in Switzerland because he's gay?" Keratin cleared his throat, his pupils dilating.
"Exiling a gay son is not so unusual."
"Even if he's in contact with a foreign intelligence service?"
"Fuck," mumbled Keratin.
He slumped in his seat, rubbing his face as if trying to make the conversation go away. "I understand the Russians like to re-educate homosexuals," said De Payne, keeping his voice flat but strong. "The Chechens in particular. It's not pretty, but highly effective, I hear." Keratin winced.
"Look, I love my son. He's not here because I'm ashamed."
"I don't doubt it," said De Payne, seeing that Nikolai had moved to the bar and was ordering drinks. Nikolai is an impressive young man. Keratin sat up, seeming unsure whether to be sad or angry.
"I knew this moment would come one day. Please don't do this. There is no need."
De Payne kept talking, knowing the entire interaction was being recorded by Aline from the bag on her table. "You'll be contacted in Russia by a man named Guy. He'll introduce himself as a friend from Geneva. I suggest you respond positively to his requests, for the survival of your son, and perhaps to also stop your career from submerging." Nikolai returned with the drinks and resumed his seat.
"So, have you got acquainted?"
he asked, with a boyish quality evident now he was less nervous.
"How do you like my friend, Dad? I told you he was fun."
"Your friend is very nice," said Keratin, eyeballing the Frenchman.
De Payne stood. "Well, I know how much you have missed each other, so I'll leave you to have some quality family time." He turned to Keratin. "Sir, it was very nice meeting you. Maybe we'll meet again."
"I don't think so," said Keratin, with a brief, hate-filled glance. "But you never know."
De Payne passed the Russian thugs in the lobby and stepped out into the street. He crossed the road and walked north along the Quai de Mont Blanc, finding some shade from the trees that separated the famous street from the lake. He now had to conduct a tourniquet overseen by the three-person mission team, ending at a plan de support, an advertising poster at a bus stop on the Rue des Paquis, which would feature a sticker or gommette. If the sticker was red, he was being followed, and he'd move to an exfiltration plan. The route took 16 minutes, his team detecting if he had followers, and communicating with one another over the radio net. He walked to a Coca-Cola ad on the bus stop and saw the red gommette. Yet, just because there was a tail, it didn't mean he could break from his legend and start acting like a spy. He kept walking and entered Geneva's central railway station, walking to a magazine stand where he pretended to be interested in a publication. He waited for a train to arrive, and when there was a crowd pouring down the main concourse, he joined them. After 10 seconds, he took a sudden turn to the right and walked out a side passage into the sunshine and onto the grounds of the Art and Design School. He walked out the other side of the campus, leapt onto a tram, and rode it 4 blocks west before jumping off and treating himself to a browse through a 3-story department store. When De Payns was sure he no longer had a follower, he moved to the dead mailbox that had been set up along with the tourniquet and had now been armed with a white gommette at the end of a street called Rue Jean Gutenberg. He followed the street for 20 seconds before seeing a red bicycle with a wicker basket parked outside a bakery. From the basket, he grabbed a white envelope, left there by Aline, and quickly dropped his French ID card in the name of Guillaume Roger in another envelope in the basket. De Payns kept walking, and at the end of the street put the sticker he was carrying on a concrete lamppost, which told Aline he'd made the exchange, and she could return for the envelope. De Payns walked to the Crown Plaza, where a room had been booked under the name on the new ID card he'd just picked up, Benoit Droulet. The booking had been made by Renon, an infrastructure honorable correspondent, HC, working in the hotel. An HC arranged important materiel and services for visiting OTs. Renon worked in the Crown Plaza and would ensure no bank details were needed and there was no trace for the Russians. In his room, De Payns lay on the hotel bed, cycling his breathing. He felt safe in this hotel because Renon was a clan member, one of a secret group that included Shrek, Templar, Rocket, and himself, who were sworn to support one another. That's how De Payns worked, and it was what he relied on for his sanity. He visualized every step of the morning and the tourniquet. He thought about faces he'd seen in the hotel and on the tram, and what he might have missed. He thought about Nikolai, and about Nikolai's father's face when De Payns had given him the facts, the dévoilement. He thought about how the scenario could be turned on his own family, and quickly pushed that thought down as far as it would go. Chapter 2. De Payns flew into Orly on Friday morning and rode the Orlyval shuttle to the Place de la Bastille, where he sat down in the Hippopotamus Café at 10:29 a.m. Before he could pick up his menu, a man 10 meters away took a blue cap from his table, put it on his head, and walked onto the street. De Payns followed the man for 6 minutes into a quiet side street, where the man took off his cap, and De Payns heard a silver VW Golf starting beside him. The man walked on, and De Payns got in the car. "Good morning," said De Payns to the driver, who was his colleague and friend, Gégé. He didn't know the woman in the passenger seat, so he didn't use names. They drove east across Paris to the suburb of Noisy, and after clearing the security gate, which De Payns had to do without company ID, Gégé pulled up outside the side entrance of the bunker. The headquarters of the Y Division was an old fort, set in parklands and surrounded by a castle wall that had somehow stayed erect through the centuries. Known as the Bunker, the fort was the home of the company's operations section, the Y Division. It was physically separated from the other DGSE divisions, intelligence, technical, and administration, which were situated at Boulevard Mortier in central Paris. "The boss wants to see you," said Gégé with a smile as De Payns climbed from the car. "No pressure, mon pote." De Payns entered through the secret employee's entrance, ran up the stairs to the first floor, and walked the squeaking floorboards to his small office with its eastward views over the leafier part of Paris. The office was plain and government issue, with a nondescript desk, a basic safe on the floor in the corner, and a keyboard and screen with no port for a thumb drive or any accessories. His French rugby team coffee mug was the only personal item on his desk. Around him, he could hear other officiers traitants banging on their keyboards. The French Secret Service was capable of interesting adventures, but the whole show ran on reports and briefs. Grabbing his mug, he made for the kitchenette and made himself a capsule coffee. He was reaching for the sugar when a throat was cleared behind him. He turned to see Margot, Dominique Briffaut's middle-aged executive assistant, who stalked the halls of the bunker doing the work of a sergeant-at-arms. "The boss is waiting for you," she said without preamble. He thanked her, but she was already walking away. He followed her up the stairs to the top floor and through the antechamber to Briffaut's office. "Go right in," said Margot. De Payns shut the door behind him as he entered. At the desk, with a view of Paris behind him, was Dominique Briffaut, head of the Y Division. He was a solidly built man of West African heritage who had been recruited from French special forces. Even in his early 50s, he looked as though he could operate in the field.
"So," said Briffaut, polishing an apple on his shirt, "how did it go?"
De Payns took a seat. "I think we won the first round. He wasn't expecting it."
"Do we have a reliable source?"
De Payns nodded. "I think it'll hold for a while, but Jim will have to be careful. Even if Keratin loves his son, he might still declare the approach to save his career." Briffaut looked at De Payns.
"I know how you feel about Jim, but you'll have to get over it."
He bit into the apple. De Payns felt his nostrils flare. Jim Valley, the company's OT who would handle Keratin in Russia, had worked for Philippe Maneri, a corrupt director of the DGS, the company's internal affairs directorate. It was Jim who had recently taken De Payns' wife, Hiromi, and his two sons on an abduction simulation, designed to leverage De Payns' silence. Briffaut continued.
"Jim is pretty good at what he does, and the investigation showed that he was just obeying Maneri's orders. He had no idea he was betraying the company."
De Payns made a face. The cat would rather redeploy a wayward employee than risk dirty laundry finding its way into the newspapers.
"I guess putting him in the DR is what they had to do." "And I guess I had to agree to it," said Briffaut flatly.
De Payns wondered what Romy would say if she found out her husband now worked with the man who'd abducted her and their children.
"We received an urgent request from the DR," said Briffaut, tapping a file on his desk. "A source produced some serious stuff. Looks like the Russians are deploying those new observation drones at Khmeimim in Syria."
"Okay," said De Payns, intrigued. The Russians' new DA-42NG drone was used by their intelligence service, the FSB, in areas where it was up to no good. Mali, Libya, Chechnya. It wasn't a general surveillance aircraft. Deploying it at Khmeimim, the Russian airbase on Syria's Mediterranean coast, indicated Russian escalation.
"The documents suggest the SVR are also beefing up operations at their Tartus Navy base."
"Shit," said De Payns.
"One of the documents the source supplied mentions a deal between the Russians and another party. It's due to go down on a UAE-owned boat called Azam in 2 weeks' time."
"Where's the boat?" asked De Payns.
"It will be in Monaco," said Briffaut. "In a separate email, there's mention of a person with an associated phone number. The phone was just located in Genoa."
De Payns repressed a sigh. No doubt this meant more travel, the possible sabotage of his weekend plans, and almost definitely a fight with his wife, Romy.
"I want you to leave for Genoa on Monday," said Briffaut, as if reading De Payns' mind. "Take a technician with a spinner and put a face and an ID on this number and the person operating it. We're calling him Starkand. Operation is Bellbird." The boss pushed a file across the desk. This was a DAO, a Demande d'Aval d'Opération, the official tasking by the DR for the Y Division to go to work. De Payne opened it and looked at the attached printout with the phone number of Starkan's phone. On your way to Genoa, you can stop in Monaco and get us access to Azam, Brifor added. We need someone on board, or we need to bug it in advance. We have to know who's talking and what they're saying. De Payne stared at him. Do I look like Harry Houdini to you? How do you want me to set this up in 2 weeks? We have an HC in Monaco, said Brifo. An old-timer. His name's Johnny. He's been asleep for 10 years.
10 years? Echoed De Payne.
I'll have to blow the cobwebs off him.
Save your judgment for the meeting, said Brifo, pushing a second file across the desk. Here's his file. The plan de liaison to wake him up is inside. If he replies, go see him. If not, we'll find something else.
De Payne breathed out and avoided Brifo's stare. You'll have to go Monday at the latest. De Payne hissed. That means goodbye to my weekend. I was away this week. Life is tough, said Brifo, trying to smile. But so are you. Yeah, right, said De Payne. In that case, I'll take next Friday off and spend a long weekend with the family. Brifo shrugged acceptance. And let me know if you're meeting Johnny. De Payne nodded. Can I take Lolo as the technician? If you want, but make sure he uses his brain this time, otherwise he's out. What do you mean? Asked De Payne, chuckling. When he gets in the field, he goes all James Bond and thinks with his underpants. Understood, boss, said De Payne. I'll make sure he doesn't jump on anyone. Brifor nodded his approval, his attention already on another set of files. There was a knock on the door. That'll be Shrek, said Brifor. You can let him in on your way out.
Chapter 3.
Shrek stood back from Brifor's door and muttered a quick hello to Aguilar as his friend left the boss's office.
Come in, Shrek, the boss called.
Shrek shut the door behind him, and the head of Y Division waved him to a seat.
What I'm about to tell you doesn't leave this room, understand? Ordered Brifo. At least, not before Monday.
Shrek nodded.
Got it. You know Paul Degard?
From the Russian desk?
Sure, but not well. 2 days ago, he had a nasty surprise after returning from a foreign trip.
Shrek sat up.
In Paris?
Yep, said Brifo, balling his big fists on the desk. His wife and daughter were pretty shaken up, but Degard didn't make it.
Fuck, said Shrek before he could stop himself.
That was my reaction. DGS have taken the wife and child out of harm's way.
What happened? Asked Shrek.
DGS checked his last text messages, and he was well clear after seeing his source and leaving the country.
Shrek's mind whirled. OTs were constantly reminded to be especially careful when they landed back in Paris, back from the moon. That's when they were at their most vulnerable, tired from the mission and wanting to get home. That's when they were tempted to take shortcuts, which was why the importance of being clean for the last mile was hammered into them so forcefully.
Brifo continued. He was clean into Charles de Gaulle, but he took a taxi straight home from the airport.
Shrek almost felt sick.
Quel con! What an idiot!
It's done now. Our job is to work back and find who did this. I want you to go see Degard's wife, make her talk. We need her to spit out all her memories.
DGS are finished? Asked Shrek, aware that the company's internal affairs officers sealed off such scenarios as if the entire organization was leaky.
Not officially, but I'll get you a window of a couple of hours, and you have my authority to use all your skills.
Shrek nodded. He was known for an interview style that got results without the need for raised voices or threats.
A lot of manipulation, yes, but no threats. And just so you know, the source de Garde was handling was Lotus. You see what I mean?
I see, said Trek.
In other words, Paul de Garde had probably dragged a bunch of Russians into Paris.
I'll give you the address on Monday, said Briffaut.
Briffaut hit his intercom and was talking to Margot as Shrek left. De Payns flipped through the file Briffaut had given him. The picture of Johnny must have been at least 20 years old. He wondered why the Corsican had been put to sleep for a decade, and whether it had to do with his reliability. He found Johnny's contact phone number and the wake-up authentication script in the back of the thin file. Smiling at the old-school script, which was reminiscent of the clandestine liaison tools they were taught at Sercotte, the DGSE training facility outside of Orléans, he picked up the phone and dialed. A voice answered after two rings, a gravelly male voice, wheezy like the Godfather's. With authentic Corsican manners, the voice simply said,
Yes?
Can I rent a house in the countryside, behind Nice? Asked De Payns.
The holidays are over, so it's a good time right now,
the Corsican replied without hesitation.
Tell me what you need.
I need fresh air, said De Payns.
Let's meet on Monday at the Hotel de Paris, the Bar Américain, 6 p.m.
De Payns agreed and put down the phone. The entire interaction had taken 20 seconds, and at the end of it, he had a meeting with Johnny, and he knew the man was a professional. It was mid-afternoon when De Payns reached the safe house, which in the company was called an OCP, or Operational Clandestine Premises. It was located in an anonymous building in the 11th arrondissement. He entered the week's numerical code into the number pad at the building's portico and pushed through the door as the bolts slid back. He now stood in an internal antechamber with a closed security door in front of him and listened to the security bolts slide home in the door behind him. He waited for 30 seconds, then, when the green light was illuminated on the number pad for the next door, he input the DGSE's daily code and entered. He wanted to make this quick. With his reports on Geneva written, he was able to leave work early, and now he had a good shot at making it home for dinner with Romy and his sons, 6-year-old Oliver and 8-year-old Patrick. It could be a struggle to make time for his family, while at the same time having to put them in a sealed compartment when he was operational. He intended to make the most of these few precious hours he had stolen before he had to leave for Monaco and Genoa. He walked past one bedroom, made up for agents on the move, and glanced into another room consisting of servers and a desk with a computer. He continued on through the kitchen to his locker, where he located a manila envelope labeled Benoit Droulé. Taking off his watch and emptying his pockets of wallet and phone, De Payns stripped himself of his false identity and placed the items in the envelope. He changed his brown leather loafers for a pair of Asics trainers and switched his blue sports coat for a windbreaker. Then he opened the envelope labeled Home. He put on his own watch, checked his wallet, and put his phone in his jeans pocket. Then he left via the secret rear door, emerging in a service lane, and headed for the metro. It was just before 5 o'clock when he reached the second floor landing of his apartment building and paused at the Napoleon-era door. The address he'd secured for his family was well above what he and Romy could afford in the private housing market, but after a recent security scare, when Philippe Manery was revealed as a mole in the company, the De Payns family had been relocated to a beautiful apartment in the 13th arrondissement, reserved for well-connected military and intelligence officers. He pushed through the door and, out of habit, deadlocked it behind him. From down the hall he could smell fish baking and the sounds of SpongeBob making sense of his world. He emerged in the large kitchen and living area and saw his sons lying in front of the television.
Hi, Dad,
called out Patrick, who had a mouthful of orange. Oliver rolled a Lego machine of war across the carpet, oblivious to his surrounds. De Payns wandered down the hall and found Romy at her computer in the spare bedroom. She had changed from her professional clothes into jeans and a tight-fitting tank top.
De Payns had a quick flash of what if, and put on his best smile. But her expression when she looked up from the screen put pay to that idea. I have to rewrite a report, she said. Can you take care of dinner and deal with the boys? Before De Payns could answer, she added, and you'll need to do the shopping. There's nothing for breakfast. Can I have a shower first? He replied, being sure to wipe any sarcasm from his tone. Her policy job at the Tyrol Council environmental think tank was demanding, and even if it was a little lefty, it gave Romy a chance to make a difference in green energy, and he was trying to support her. Romy eyeballed him. I've dealt with the boys on my own for the last 2 days, and I work too, remember? Okay, I've got it covered, said De Payns. He'd been hoping for a pleasant evening, but decided he might as well rip off the band-aid now since they were already sniping at each other. I'm off on Monday for 3 days or so. Romy gave him a look. Do they do this on purpose? They know you have a family, right? Yes, they know. So, they want you to lose that family? De Payns shifted his stance. Is that a threat? It's not a threat. It's fucking exhausting. That's what it is. In De Payns' experience, once Romy started swearing, she was digging in for a fight. It's important, he said. Oh, it's important, is it? She said, slapping her hands on the desk either side of the keyboard. You're out there playing cowboys and Indians while there are people working on real plans for the planet. Cowboys and Indians? Echoed De Payns, a little shocked. That's what you think I do? She shook her head, the anger going out of her. We have different views on how to save the world, that's all. You and your friends use violence, while the people I work with are about ideas and collaboration, trying to build a better world for our kids. And who protects the kids? He asked, the words escaping before he could stop them. An economist with a TED talk? De Payns stood in the shower, seething, angry with Romy for her intellectual snobbery, and furious with himself for rising to the bait. His wife was smart, and so were her colleagues, but that didn't make him a caveman with a club, and it didn't make her idealism a shield against some of the monsters he'd met. Truth was, he wished Romy and the Tyrol Council were right. That clean energy and aggressive wealth redistribution policies would solve the world's evils. Unfortunately, human beings tended towards power and personal gain, and as long as human nature prevailed, the common good would never be the objective of all. There were people out there so greedy and disrespectful of their fellow humans that they would not be stopped until someone like Templar held them by the throat and squeezed the life out of them. Templar did not do TED Talks or go to cocktail parties, but Templar was prepared to walk in the dark and protect those who couldn't. De Payns avoided telling Romy that her husband was also prepared to fight in the dark arena so that civilians could live in peace. But he wasn't going to win an argument with Romy by spelling out what he and his colleagues did to keep her kids safe. He thought about his mission to Monaco as the warm water ran down him, and he worked hard to push thoughts of the mission and Johnny out of his head. Stepping out of the shower, he dried and dressed quickly and returned to Romy in the spare room. Hugging her and reading what she was typing on her computer, he said into her ear, "Sorry, honey. I went too far. Thank you for trying to save the world. Next weekend I'll take Friday off, and we'll go to Dovi." He sensed a smile as he kissed her earlobe. I'm off to do the shopping, he said. Chapter 4. De Payns flipped breakfast pancakes and pointed to the coffee he'd made for Romy. Drink your coffee, he said, as she drifted around the apartment, loudly looking for a favored hair clip. I said no TV before school. De Payns growled as Patrick hit the remote and the screen came to life. It was 7:28 a.m. on Monday, and De Payns was playing his part in the weekday morning routine, painfully aware that he'd soon be heading for Monaco and leaving Romy to cope on her own with the kids. De Payns and the boys had enjoyed the weekend, kicking the soccer ball, practicing some karate, and eating at a Japanese restaurant where the boys had food thrown into their bowls by a chef who played ABBA on his little speaker. He'd drunk wine and gone to bed early with his wife. Not a bad result for a cowboy. Romy returned to the kitchen, her hair up and her heels sounding harsh on the polished wooden boards. "I have a new rule for the males in this house," she said, sipping her coffee carefully so as not to ruin her lipstick or splash the white shirt she wore under her blazer. "Don't touch my stuff." "Where was it?" asked De Payns, pointing to the tortoiseshell hair clip now in her hair. "On the Lego box," she said. "The boys are going to Anna's after school, and she's taking them to karate. I'm picking them up from there." "Okay," said De Payns. He deposited the pancakes on a plate, then walked her to the door. She kissed him. "Be careful," she said. "And what I said about you playing cowboys and Indians? I only say things like that because I can't bear to think about what you actually do." "I know," he said, accepting a kiss. She pushed away from his arms. "And remind the boys that Anna's getting them from school." "Okay," said De Payns. She walked across the foyer, her shoes clicking on marble, echoing against the vaulted ceilings. "Eat up, boys," he yelled as he strode down the hallway. "We leave in 9 minutes." Their walk to school involved a detailed discussion on Paris Saint-Germain Football Club and a teacher called Mr. Simmons, who was from England and taught music. He apparently had a terrible sense of humor and liked to play Deutschlandlied to see the looks on the French kids' faces. "Tell him that a German wrote the music to God Save the Queen," said De Payns. "Is that true?" asked Patrick as they emerged on Avenue du Maine. "Maybe not," said De Payns as they waited at a pedestrian crossing. "But we just want to see the look on his silly English face, no?" The boys were still laughing as they crossed the street towards the school. He said goodbye, all the parents quickly putting on their COVID masks to prove they were responsible. One of them, a well-dressed Parisienne, walked towards De Payns and his boys, dropping her mask as she did. "Hi, Anna," said De Payns, as her son Charles ran to play-punch Oliver. Anna Homsey smiled, a flash of teeth beneath intelligent dark eyes and a high forehead. "You have the idea, Alec," she said, pointing at De Payns' face. "I should do that." "Dad never wears one," said Patrick. "We tell him, but he never remembers." De Payns cottoned on. "Oh, this thing," he said, touching the mask that usually sat at his throat. "Do I have to wear one outside?" Anna laughed. "Who knows?" "No one knows," said Oliver. "So many laws and rules that you can't obey them all," said Anna with a smile. "But the government always has something to arrest you for." "Too many rules. Maybe that's why PSG keeps losing," said Patrick, and Anna laughed. De Payns found himself laughing along with this charming woman, Syrian by descent, but with no Arab accent. He had a flash of insight into his boys, accepting the care and affection of an adult outside their immediate family. He wondered where he had been during this transition, in which Romy and Anna had stitched together a series of arrangements in order to pursue their own careers. It relied on a child's trust and a parent's authority, which in this group was Anna. De Payns felt like a bystander, and Anna's attempts to make him feel less like one just made it more obvious. The boys moved towards the school gate. "Anna's getting you from school," De Payns reminded the boys as he hugged them goodbye. "We know," said Oliver, following his older brother into the school grounds. "It's Monday." After two metro journeys and a bus, De Payns arrived at the bunker and went straight to his office, where he took his small backpack from the safe in the corner. A soft rap on the door behind him announced Margot's presence. "Aguilar, boss wants to see you. He's in the park." He descended the stairs past the Y Division gym, emerging into the cool morning sunshine of the fort's parklands. 30 meters away, Dominique Briffaut gesticulated with his cigarette at a woman in her mid-30s, Greta, who appeared to be listening, but, judging by the expression on her face, not agreeing. De Payns stood off, waiting for his boss to call him over. Greta stalked away from Briffaut and gave De Payns an annoyed look as she passed. No doubt another OT who'd been told, "Thanks for your opinion, now do as you're told." Briffaut extended a pack of Camels and lighter as De Payns approached. "We all set for Genoa?" De Payns took a smoke and lit it. "We'll be out of here by 9:30. "Lolo's using the big head?" asked Briffaut. De Payns shrugged. "I'm told Lolo's sharp. He'll find that phone." "What about Monaco? You contacted Johnny?"
"Yep," said De Payns. "We're on for tonight."
"Be careful with him," said Briffaut. "His job is to get us on a boat. Don't get lured into his bullshit."
De Payns nodded and took a drag on his cigarette.
Briffaut's gaze shifted to another OT who was waiting to talk to the boss. "Don't linger down there. I need you back in Paris." Chapter 5. De Payns keyed in through a security door to the bunker's basement level, housing both the Y Division car park and the Y9 group, which provided cyber and technology support for operations. De Payns walked past the mechanics bay to where the tall, shaven-headed figure of Lolo Souquet stood beside a silver Renault Megane.
"This is us?" asked De Payns as he approached the car and slipped off his pack.
"Sure is, boss," said Lolo. He was dressed in a brown biker's jacket, black shirt, and black jeans. In his late 20s, Lolo had been recruited out of the Université Paris-Nanterre, where he was a junior lecturer in electrical engineering. He was smart, but he'd had limited time in the field, certainly nothing approaching De Payns' experience.
"Everything ready?" asked De Payns, placing his pack on the back seat.
"Whiskey and cigarettes?" said Lolo with a smile. "Condoms, too."
"Think with the big head, Lolo," said De Payns.
"We got our matos?" The Y9 group usually worked on cyber operations in the bowels of the bunker, or in operations vans, subs, supporting missions with high-powered listening posts and data hacks. The chance to travel with a field operative to Monaco and Genoa might sound like shaken martinis for the tech people, but De Payns treated the trip as routine, and his priority was to ensure he had his materials, matos, in the car.
"The plates and papers are in the spare tire well," said Lolo, referring to the change of number plates and registration papers carried by OTs traveling out of Paris.
"The spinning laptop and camera are loaded and fully charged, plus we've got backup batteries and a stack of clean SD cards."
"Tracker?" asked De Payns.
"Two of them, also fully charged," said Lolo, giving the thumbs up.
"ID?" asked De Payns,
meaning, did Lolo have the basics to pass as someone else while in Italy?
"Yep, did some gardening on the weekend," said Lolo,
referring to the small actions in and around an OT's false address that firmed up the assumed ID. De Payns nodded and pointed to the dangling silver earring Lolo wore in his left lobe.
"That'll have to go."
"Just a couple of square guys, huh?" replied Lolo, reaching for the earring.
"Something like that," said De Payns, opening the driver's door.
They made fast time on the A6 out of Paris, which went through Auxerre and bypassed Dijon, where De Payns had been based as a fighter pilot during the Kosovo conflict. It was a part of his life that had been so important at the time, but the great pride he'd once felt was fading with the years. De Payns had been cleared to fly combat in Mirage 2000 fighters at the age of 21, and he remembered every sortie over the Balkans. But a back injury and spinal surgery had meant he could no longer fly fighter jets, and he found it easier these days not to dwell on it. Easier, perhaps, because the early days with Romy occurred when De Payns flew, and it was that version of him she remembered so fondly. They stopped for lunch at a total roadhouse just north of Villefranche, and De Payns opted for one of the outdoor tables so he could sneak a smoke after his baguette. He was aware of his senior role at the bunker,
and the fact that early career people like Lolo were hungry for insights and wisdom. He didn't mind talking about tradecraft and some of the lessons he'd learned, but he also lived in a world of information compartments, so being interrogated by a younger OT could be exhausting. He wiped his fingers and put a cigarette to his lips. "So, Lolo," he said, lighting the smoke as Lolo played with his tuna salad, "you're fairly new at the bunker. What's your story?" Lolo smiled. "I did electrical engineering at the Université Paris-Nanterre, and then I became a junior lecturer in telecoms engineering. I worked briefly at Vodafone, and now..." He shrugged. "What did you do at Vodafone?" "Tower testing, network commissioning. You know, propagation delay, latency, basic fix-it algorithms, and some code overwrites." De Payns smiled. "Basic, huh?" Lolo looked away. "Some people can sing, some can hit a golf ball. This is my thing." "I'm told you're the best we have on a spinner," said De Payns. "We're looking for a phone number currently being used in Genoa, and with a spinner in place, we hope to identify the user. You been in the field before?" "I passed the basic courses at Sercot," said Lolo. "I've been in the sub," referring to the vehicles used by the company for observation, "but nothing like this." "Where have you operated?" Lolo went to answer, then stopped himself. "Actually, no comment." "Good answer," said De Payns, glancing at his watch. "Enjoying the job?" Lolo shrugged. "I'm loving it, but this is the part that I really want to do." "In the field?" asked De Payns, subtly watching a couple at the neighboring table who looked stilted in their interaction. "For sure," said Lolo. "It would be great to see how to do it properly." At the next table, the woman shook her head and looked away from the man. They were having a domestic. They weren't watchers. "Doing it properly takes a lot of anxiety," said De Payns. "You'll get the hang of it." They sat on the speed limit as they motored south, and De Payns used the time to bring Lolo up to speed on their first liaison in Monaco. "I'll be meeting someone at the Bar Américain in the Hotel de Paris," said De Payns. "His name is Johnny, and you won't come with me. I need you sitting in a corner, looking like you belong there, but keeping an eye on things. You'll cover the contact." "An eye on things?" De Payns turned down the radio. "You'll get out of the car a few blocks from the Monte Carlo casino and take a stroll, checking your..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.